There has been very few movies in the history of the world that have completely changed our world. And in 1999, a movie titled The Matrix hit the world stage. It was released on March 31st, 1999, which is Easter weekend. And since then, it has become a cultural icon. There has been countless parodies from all kinds of different genres of filmmaking, of cartoons that have mimicked the scenes from this movie. It was groundbreaking in its technology, in its filming, in its storyline, and the world responded wildly to it. Listen to how this has impacted even the actors that played these parts in these movies and changed their worlds.
I'm amazed at their point of view about reality and about the human brain.
It altered people's thoughts. What is real? What is reality?
Even in my own life, just looking around and being like, oh my God, we're in the Matrix. I would literally think that.
It's sort of impossible to articulate how it's seeped into our minds and culture. I can't even remember not having seen it. I can't remember my life before the world of the Matrix.
The Matrix as an idea has lasted 20 years. People use terminology like, are you gonna take the red pill?
You're either gonna take that blue pill or you're gonna take the red.
Everything entered pop culture and stayed. We say a glitch in the Matrix, the fact that that's part of the lexicon.
I think this is one of the few movies that has really seeped its way into every kind of facet of popular culture.
Oh, I'll run into young people who've done college courses. All of the philosophies and ideas around the Matrix.
It's this amazing, magical, mythological world that has been created using numbers and digits. But it's actually about consciousness. It's actually about thought.
You'll hear the sentences, the Matrix changed my life. So I say thank you, changed mine too.
The books that have been written on The Matrix have attributed this story to being a retelling of the gospel, a retelling of the story of Christ in our modern setting. Maybe that's perhaps why it's so popular, because we live in a country where everyone is talking about Jesus, has heard about Jesus, and maybe that's what's resonated with people, or maybe there's something else. In the very beginning of The Matrix, we hear that Neo, the main character, is very much like Jesus. In fact, when he gets picked up by the three agents and interrogated, this is the first time that we hear a little bit about his name and what he does for a living.
As you can see, we've had our eye on you for some time now, Mr. Anderson. It seems that you've been living two lives. In one life, you're Thomas A. Anderson, program writer for a respectable software company. You have a social security number, you pay your taxes, and you help your landlady carry out her garbage. The other life is lived in computers, where you go by the hacker alias Neo and are guilty of virtually every computer crime we have a law for.
So it's very interesting, the information that's told to us. He has two lives, almost like Jesus was God in heaven and then came down to our earth as a man. His name was Thomas Anderson, right? The first part of the word Anderson is Ander, which comes from the Greek word man. His name is also Neo, which is Greek for new. So he's the new Son of Man. Now who's the Son of Man? The Bible tells us exactly who the Son of Man is in Luke 19:10. For the Son of Man is come to seek and save that which is lost. So here they're calling Neo to be like the Savior. Now, if you remember what this little conversation between the agent and him said, he lives two lives. One life, he is very obedient, does everything he's told to. And in the other life, he is a hacker, a thief, and a terrible person. Now, is that like Jesus? When the Wachowskis were asked about the names in these movies, they basically responded with this. They were all chosen carefully, and all of them have multiple meanings. Let's just go over a couple of the names of some of the characters that become friends with Neo and end up being the heroes of the story. Morpheus, one of the main characters that frees Neo from his controlled environment, is named Morpheus after the Greek mythology, the god of sleep. Trinity, of course, has some Christianity-sounding roots to it. Cypher is sort of like the Judas character that becomes the betrayer of Neo, and his name means a secret or disguised way of writing. Switch, who was also part of their team, she was actually supposed to be a female in the Matrix and a male in the real world, and so they called her Switch so that she could transform back and forth from a transgender world. And then you have APOC. Maybe that's possibly short for Apocalypse. I don't know, but all of them kind of sound like they have biblical meaning. So we're going to take a look at this. Why does he have all of these Christ-like parallels? There was constant references throughout the movie that he was like Jesus or is Jesus.
Hallelujah. You're my savior, man. My own personal Jesus Christ.
Did he tell you why he did it? Why you're here? Jesus! What a mind job. So you're here to save the world.
So all these little references really put in your mind when you're watching this movie that Neo is just like Jesus. When Neo is being introduced into the Nebuchadnezzar for the very first time, Morpheus is introducing him to the rest of the team. As they're walking through and saying, this is the Nebuchadnezzar, this is our ship, this is where we live, there is this very interesting plaque that pans across the screen. Very kind of interesting that they would choose the name of the King of Babylon to be naming the ship after. But I want you to notice above the name Nebuchadnezzar, it says Mark 3, number 11. In Mark 3:11, it says, when the unclean spirits saw him, they fell down and cried and said, thou art the Son of God. Some director had to tell the art department to make a plaque and to put that Bible text on the top of this plaque. That is not a mistake. The third one, he even dies like Jesus in a crucifixion pose. And it's very constant throughout all of these films that they are not mistaking who they want you to think this character is. But if you examine just a little bit closer, you will see that they're actually talking about a very different Jesus. Listen to this scene when Neo asks them where the city of Zion is.
Genuine child of Zion.
Zion?
If the war was over tomorrow, Zion's where the party would be.
Where is it?
Deep underground. Near the Earth's core where it's still warm.
It's very interesting that they take this character, they kind of stamp the idea that this is Jesus, but then they start to flip the whole model on its head. And they start to show you that Zion isn't something that's in heaven, Zion is something underneath the Earth. And when you see what Zion actually looks like in this movie, it doesn't have the appearance of heaven. It has more of an appearance of hell. And notice how they constantly make the reference, they want to be free, they want to be free.
The script that they wrote synthesized to me, you know, it had Gibson, it had Vern, it had K. Dick, Frank Miller, anime, Kurosawa, Peckinpah, it was Nietzsche, it was Buddha, it was Christ. It was themes and levels. It was dualities, modalities, realities, dreams, will, destiny, freedom, slavery of the mind, of the body, the construct, who lives, who dies, identity, sexuality, viruses, and love. It was mythology, philosophy, technology, and truth.
What truth is exactly what we're discussing today? They're putting this idea out there that this is blending all kinds of religious and philosophical ideas, from Buddha to Jesus to Friedrich Nietzsche, who absolutely didn't even believe in God, hated God, to Philip K. Dick. The Wachowskis were heavily influenced by Philip K. Dick. And Philip K. Dick was a Gnostic writer. So when the Wachowski brothers were asked in an interview, "Do you know that your movie, The Matrix, has a lot of Gnostic themes in it?" They said, "Do you consider that to be a good thing?" "I would." If you look through YouTube, you can see lots of videos promoting the Gnosticism of this movie. There's been Gnostic discussions from all kinds of Gnostic churches and people that subscribe to that religious belief that have recognized this is a movie that teaches this point of view. So what exactly is Gnosticism? The Gnostics believed that God was an unknowable, a transcendent God that you couldn't get to know. And this God created a God Sophia. And he also created a God named Yaldabaoth. To the Gnostics, this God Yaldabaoth was the creator of the earth, and he actually created it to be evil. And so the Gnostics said the snake was the one that gave the people the knowledge that they were being controlled. But the Bible doesn't say that at all. The Bible says that it's the devil, the serpent, that was possessing that snake and telling Eve an absolute lie. Listen to what the Gnostics believe about the serpent.
The Gnostics were convinced that the serpent in the Garden of Eden was a good figure. In fact, the Gnostics turned the story of the Garden of Eden upside down, because the serpent was a rather engaging character. After all, the serpent said to Eve, "Take some of the fruit from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil." And to Gnostics, that sounded like a wonderful invitation. Wouldn't you like to have a bite of an apple of knowledge?
Gnostics believe that we have a spark of divinity inside of us. You can see that same lie from the tree of knowledge of good and evil still being taught to people today, that you are gods deep down inside. When the Wachowski brothers were asked, "What is your favorite scene in The Matrix?" this is how they responded. If you're talking about the pill scene, that is our favorite too.
"Do you believe in fate, Neo?"
"No."
"Why not?"
"Because I don't like the idea that I'm not in control of my life."
"I know exactly what you mean."
That's not what the Bible teaches, right? We are to die daily, to not be in control, to give that control over to God. It's only Satan that said, "I don't want to have any controls over me whatsoever. I want to be in control of my own way, my own life."
"Let me tell you why you're here. You're here because you know something. You felt it your entire life, that there's something wrong with the world. You don't know what it is, but it's there. It is this feeling that has brought you to me. Do you know what I'm talking about?"
"The Matrix."
"Do you want to know what it is?"
He's saying, "Don't you want to know? Don't you want the knowledge?" That's exactly what happened in the Garden of Eden. He's telling Eve, "Don't you want the knowledge of good and evil, and to know and be just like gods?"
"The Matrix is everywhere. It is all around us. Even now, in this very room, you can see it when you look out your window or when you turn on your television. You can feel it when you go to work, when you go to church, when you pay your taxes. It is the world that has been pulled over your eyes to blind you from the truth."
"What truth?"
You see, Morpheus is wanting Neo to believe that he is in a controlled environment, that there's something that he's been lied to, and that Morpheus has the answers, and that he can lead him into the path of knowledge.
"That you are a slave, Neo. Like everyone else, you were born into bondage, born into a prison that you cannot smell or taste or touch. A prison for your mind."
You were born into a controlled environment, born into a world that you cannot taste and you cannot touch. Go back to Genesis 3. What did Eve say to the serpent? "If I touch it or I eat it, I will die." And the serpent says, "You won't die." This exact scene right here is a modern recreation of that story at the Garden of Eden with the snake tempting Eve.
"Unfortunately, no one can be told what the Matrix is. You have to see it for yourself."
You see, Eve did not know what evil was. It was never God's design for Eve to even know or understand evil. That was what the devil was offering, was do you want the knowledge of good and evil? You have to experience it yourself.
This is your last chance. After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pill, the story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want to believe. You take the red pill, you stay in Wonderland, and I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes. Remember, all I'm offering is the truth, nothing more.
Morpheus telling him that all he's going to do is offer the truth, nothing more. He's not offering him eternal life. He's not offering him some salvation. He's literally offering him a piece of knowledge. After he takes the pill and swallows it with the glass of water, you notice that the thunder crashes overhead. And then Morpheus says,
"Follow me."
Follow. In Matthew 16, 24, Jesus told his disciples, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me." Very interesting that Morpheus is now telling him to come follow me. I believe that this movie is flipping the story of the gospel on its head. Neo is a new form of Christ. He's a new age Christ. In other words, he's an antichrist character. And when you start to watch the movie, you start to see the terminology pop out because all of a sudden, you hear these little biblical buzzwords, but in a bad context, such as this.
So what do you need besides a miracle?
Guns. Lots of guns.
Can you imagine if this is a representation of the Son of God that came to seek and save those which are lost? That all of a sudden he's given a bunch of high-powered weapons, AK-47s, and walks into a room and blows people away? The Son of Man, he did not come to destroy, but he came to give life, and that they might have life more abundantly. That's what the Son of God came. This is a representation of Satan. In the very beginning of The Matrix, when Cypher is on the phone with The Matrix, we see something very interesting. In the numbers that are falling to the screen, it stops and the camera shows at the very top left of the screen, 555. Now 555 is a very interesting number because there is a lot of Hollywood movies that always use the number 555. If you've ever seen anybody make a phone call, it's always to 555 something something something. But it's very interesting what 555 actually stands for. If you just look up what is the meaning of 555 on the internet, the Urban Green Witch shows you that when you see the number 555, it means an angel is trying to give you a message and a big change and transformation is coming your way.
So what does the angel number 555 mean? It means change and transformation is already happening in your life or is about to happen in your life, so be prepared. The angels want you to know that any change that you're going to be experiencing is actually good change, positive change, optimistic change.
The fact that they're even right out of the gate telling you this is going to change you. The actors who were acting in this movie said, this is going to change everyone. Anyone that watches this movie, it will change you. Society's been changed. Just look up on YouTube people that have been ultimately affected by the Matrix series and you'll find dozens and dozens of stories. When Neo, in the very beginning, picks up this book and he decides to follow the lady with the white rabbit, we see the name of the book, and it's called Simulacra and Simulation. You can see the name of the chapter that he is opening the book up to. And I want you to notice that the right side of the book is empty. It says nihilism on the top of the page. The dictionary defines nihilism as the rejection of all religious and moral principles in the belief that life is meaningless. Extreme skepticism maintaining that nothing in the world has real existence. When you look up what simulacra and simulation means, it's defined as the simulacrum is never that which conceals the truth. It is the truth that conceals that there is none. Basically saying that there is no truth.
Have you ever had a dream, Neo, that you were so sure was real? What if you were unable to wake from that dream? How would you know the difference between the dream world and the real world?
This can't
be what? Be real?
So here, Morpheus is discussing the difference between dreams and reality. And that, really, if you couldn't wake up from them, how would you know what truth really is? This theme is played throughout The Matrix over and over again. That whatever you want truth to be, you can make it up. And that's not what the Bible says. The Bible says, "Thy word is truth. Sanctify them by truth." Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Truth is the very definition of Jesus. And what this film is discussing is there is no such thing as the truth.
You've been living in a dream world, Neo.
This isn't real.
What is real? How do you define real? If you're talking about what you can feel, what you can smell, what you can taste and see, then real is simply electrical signals interpreted by your brain.
This idea that truth is not based in any sort of reality is what Morpheus is talking about right here. He's trying to convince Neo that only what your brain is interpreting as electrical signals is what truth is. In a scene with the lady with the red dress, when Morpheus is trying to teach Neo about the Matrix and what it is, I want you to pay attention to the imagery that's shown to you here. The camera starts on a do not walk sign, and notice everybody is wearing black and white. Notice there is nuns in the crowd, and when the light goes green, the people start walking across the crosswalk, and Morpheus and Neo are walking in the opposite direction. This is not accidental.
That system is our enemy. But when you're inside, you look around, what do you see? Businessmen, teachers, lawyers, carpenters.
So wait a minute, did you just catch that? He said teachers, lawyers, and carpenters. You see, Jesus was a teacher. He also was a carpenter. And the Bible describes Jesus as your advocate, which is another name for a lawyer. All three of those describe an aspect of Jesus, and he's the enemy?
Teachers, lawyers, carpenters, the very minds of the people we are trying to save. But until we do, these people are still a part of that system, and that makes them our enemy. You have to understand, most of these people are not ready to be unplugged. And many of them are so inert, so hopelessly dependent on the system, that they will fight to protect it.
It's worth pointing out the biblical significance of the woman in the red dress. In the book of Revelation, chapter 17, the Bible describes a woman in a bright red and purple dress that gains the attention of the whole world. This is a depiction of the false Church of Babylon, and it's ironic that Neo gets distracted by her. But did you notice there was also another woman? One in a white wedding dress that walked right by Neo only moments earlier, yet she passes and he doesn't even notice her? Revelation 12 speaks of another woman in a white wedding dress, which is a depiction of the true bride of Christ. This imagery here is too similar to the Bible to be ignored, which is precisely why the fandom of The Matrix pointed out this connection, as well as Screen Rant, also highlighting this biblical imagery. Morpheus telling Neo that all these people, if they are still plugged into the Matrix, they are their enemy. And that they are hopelessly dependent upon the Matrix system. This is a depiction of God and all of the people that are plugged into it. There is tons of articles on the internet that talked about noticing that the Matrix was a representation of organized religion. I don't think that's by chance why the nuns were in this scene. So you're gonna start to see that what they're depicting the Matrix to be is God or his government or anyone that serves God's government. And they are the enemy of this story.
I've seen an agent punch through a concrete wall. Men have emptied entire clips at them and hit nothing but air. Yet their strength and their speed are still based in a world that is built on rules. Because of that, they will never be as strong or as fast as you can be.
So Morpheus is letting you know exactly who these agents represent. A group of people that their whole existence and lives are built on rules and laws. That's a representation of God and his government. Anything that claims to do away with rules and laws is not God's government. That is the enemy of souls' government. Freedom is what he claims, yet he's the one that's causing a lot of bondage. True freedom comes in following God and what his precepts say. The agents are part of the Matrix system, and in this movie, they're depicted as three beings that finish each other's sentences and know what each person is thinking, and they all collectively make up what the Matrix is. And in the very end of the third movie, Neo dies and is literally placed in a crucifixion pose where when the machine is finished and he dies, that is exactly what Jesus said as he was taking his last breath and giving his spirit up to God.
It is done.
It is finished. They are not shy in letting you know who these things in this movie represent. In the very final scene of the first film, after Neo gets shot, is killed, he's resurrected back to life, we see him in the very end get on a telephone and call the Matrix. And for the first time, he has a conversation with them.
I know you're out there. I can feel you now. I know that you're afraid. You're afraid of us. You're afraid of change. I don't know the future. I didn't come here to tell you how this is going to end. I came here to tell you how it's going to begin. I'm going to hang up this phone, and then I'm going to show these people what you don't want them to see. I'm going to show them a world without you. A world without rules and controls, without borders or boundaries. A world where anything is possible. Where we go from there. It's a choice I leave to you.
As he's talking to the Matrix, he says, I don't know the future. If he really is a representation of Jesus, does Jesus know the future? Absolutely. Who doesn't know the future? The devil. And so he says, I want to show you a world with no rules, no laws, where anything is possible, and it's a world without you. Who wants to show you a world with no rules and no laws, and where anything is possible? That's not Jesus. Because the very foundation of heaven is built on rules and laws to protect us from ever having this mess that we live in today happen again. Listen to what the Bible says in Joshua 22:5. But take diligent heed to do the commandment and the law which Moses, the servant of the Lord, charged you, to love the Lord your God and to walk in all his ways and to keep his commandments and to cleave unto him and to serve him with all of your heart and all of your soul. You see, the Bible never tells us not to keep the rules. It tells us to follow what God has commanded for us and to do it with all of our hearts and all of our love. The latest installment of The Matrix called Resurrections, a biblical name, Resurrections, was released a few days before Christmas. A day that people should be thinking about Jesus or the birth of Jesus, and here this movie hits the stage. I don't believe that that was by chance. I believe that we are caught in a war and they are asking us to choose sides.
Everyone's clearly got an opinion about the Wachowskis' newest addition to their Matrix anthology, which is called The Matrix Resurrections. But only a few are talking about the strong conclusions found in this analogy. The Wachowskis' goal with this series is to change the perceptions of what is real and true with the same story retold.
We're still telling the same stories we've always told, just with different names, different faces.
Changing the perceptions of what is real by subtly seeding the audience with analogies and examples in parable form.
That's it, isn't it? If we don't know what's real, can't resist.
Over and over in The Matrix 4, the concept of what is real emerges.
These are two people that have done it their way, which is, it's amazing. It's amazing.
The Wachowski brothers are doing their part to change the minds of the population while making fun of those who know the truth. In fact, at the very end, after the credits, the creators try to deconstruct this perception through humor.
Media is nothing but neural trigger response and viral conditioning.
Wait, what are you two talking about?
Although this scene was an after-credits scene, it's quintessential to understanding the mindset of the writers. Neurotrigger response is often talked about in PTSD patients, where the soldier has been conditioned to a specific involuntary response to a sound or situation. In short, the character is saying that media is nothing but training our brain to respond without thinking. In the second part, he says media is viral conditioning, or being quickly programmed to act a certain way. So essentially, the writers have said media is nothing but quickly training our brain to act a certain way without considering the moral consequences. Of course, a bit of humor is attached to the end to make sure that the audience doesn't think too much about it, and continues to be infected with the Wachowski brothers' viral conditioning. Out of all the movies based in Hollywood that are subtly changing society, The Matrix is by far the easiest to prove that the writers were consciously trying to change society.
While The Matrix trilogy from the early 2000s amalgamated the savior concept found in the Bible, the Wachowski brothers took it a step further, stating on record that while they are proud that there are multiple interwoven analogies into The Matrix, such as the concept of good and evil, the overarching concept that they are trying to procure into impressionable minds was to tell the story of transgenderism.
Lily Wachowski confirmed this finding when he exposed the true hope for the movies was to be this transsexual analogy. He even originally wrote into the film a character that would change identities between the real world and the Matrix.
Not like this. Not like this.
The Matrix stuff was all like about the desire for transformation, but it was all coming from a closeted point of view. And so we had the character of Switch, who was like a character who would be, you know, a man in the real world, or and then a woman in the Matrix. And both were where our headspaces were. I'm glad that it has gotten out that, you know, that was the original intention, but the world wasn't quite ready at a corporate level. The corporate world wasn't ready for it, so.
A number of writers begin to catch on to the subtle hints found in the trilogy. One of them said it this way.
Emily Vanderwerf is critic at large for Vox. She wrote about trans themes in The Matrix and noticed that, quote, the movie follows characters who break free of their real life via the internet, creating online identities that feel more real than their physical ones.
I think that the main sort of thrust is really the idea that the system that you have built your life upon is a lie and is made up. And obviously that has larger applications beyond trans identities. I don't want to pretend it doesn't. But if you are a trans person, there is sort of this idea that you are living in a muffling cocoon that is keeping you from seeing the reality of yourself. And that cocoon, to some degree, is the idea of fixed gender identity, which is one that society is very like built atop.
So what is The Matrix really? It's an analogy of a system of rules that people have been taught to be their truth, according to the writers. And we can see this theme throughout the whole movie. Even from the writer's own script, it shows that the Matrix is more than a computer system that is physically connected to the human mind.
Zion was stuck in the past, stuck in war, stuck in a matrix of its own. They believed that it had to be us or them.
The character's own words use the Matrix to mean a philosophical, metaphysical allegory of how to control someone's mind through concepts and ideas, making the Matrix movie a matrix of its own.
And for everyone trapped in this meta system, the obvious course of action that the writers want to reveal is how to extract yourself from the so-called trap.
Just remind people what a free mind can do.
Free your mind.
You care more about growing fruit than freeing minds.
We are not going to have this argument.
Free my mind. Okay. Free my mind.
Which, by the way, is a strange phrase to use when the movie portrays a machine that is literally connected and attached to the innermost parts of your brain, controlling your senses while they say that they are free from the system. But the freedom that the Matrix is subtly trying to make you think about is the systems that program us to believe or think a certain way.
Are we all just algorithms doing what we're supposed to do, or can we escape our programming?
How do you know if you want something yourself or if your upbringing programmed you to want it?
These unanswered questions have very little to do with the overarching character development or storyline, but instead, they mimic the original Deceiver's method of seeding our consciousness with lies by asking questions that make us question what we know and understand as truth.
The main thing that the fourth film is about, without spoiling it, is about the idea that these binaries that we've built our lives upon are often not as cut and dry as we'd like to think. And that goes beyond gender. There's all kinds of binaries we've built within our lives. You know, good, evil is a very obvious one.
What about binaries that form the nature of things? Ones and zeros, light and dark, choice in its absence.
Maybe it's not as binary as that. Maybe there are other ways to understand what happened.
Yeah.
These binary concepts apply to more than just gender, though, like the movie said. The concept of what is real conveys the same question that Pilate gestured towards Jesus when he questioned his authority.
What is truth?
Truth, in the Matrix, is represented by the word real.
Real. There's that word again.
If we don't know what's real, can't resist.
And that is the absolute crux of the whole matter with the Wachowski brothers. If they can convey through enough mind-bending scenarios and mind-altering questions to manipulate the binary truths in your head, they can break the set of rules that you live by to initiate their own matrix inside your head.
This isn't real.
What is real? How do you define real?
With this concept in mind, it's easy to see what was actually going on inside the Wachowski brothers' minds while creating the film. In the movie, the word matrix is an allegory for the systems that make up the truth that most people believe.
The first matrix I designed was quite naturally perfect. It was a work of art, flawless, sublime.
My predecessor loved precision. His matrix was all fussy facts and equations.
A harmony of mathematical precision. I prefer counting from the emergence of one integral anomaly to the emergence of the next, in which case this is the sixth version.
The machines that run the matrix are essentially God, which the Wachowski brothers don't try to hide by the use of the name Deus Machina, which is Latin for God machine or machine God.
I work for a game company called Deus Machina.
As we have already learned, Neo is the undisputed savior in the movie. He died and was resurrected and now has godlike powers. His prophecy says that he will save Zion and the rest of humanity from these godlike machines. Many pastors have integrated the story of the Matrix into their sermons, but Neo is far from the Christ-like character we know. More on that in a moment. The architect is a machine with the residual self-image of a white-haired old man. He calls himself the Father.
I am the Father of the Matrix. I created the Matrix. I am the Architect.
Neo is given the option by the Architect to save his world by rebooting the Matrix. This reboot may reincarnate everyone into a new appearance and a new life, giving every person a new digital self-image, or DSI.
This is how you look to yourself. Somehow they were able to alter your DSI loop.
The Crucible
Of the original trilogy, has Neo given the choice to either proceed with the reboot to save all of humanity or to save his woman? It is worth noting that in the Bible, those who follow the Savior are represented by a woman in prophecy. But this movie's representation seeds the mind with the idea that Christ had a choice to save everyone or only those who love him, killing everyone else.
There are two doors. The door to your right leads to the source and the salvation of Zion. The door to your left leads back to the Matrix, to her, and to the end of your species. Hope. It is the quintessential human delusion, simultaneously the source of your greatest strength and your greatest weakness.
It's interesting that this self-professed God, the Father of the Matrix, believes hope is the quintessential human delusion. What Paul says in Romans, "May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in Him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit." By observing the world that the writers have created, we can understand the theology that they believe in. So far, we have learned that 1. The writers believe that media can be used to create viral conditioning of triggered responses. 2. The writers suggest that the Matrix is a set of binary rules defining what is good and is a system maintained by a higher power. 3. The writers continue their allegory by suggesting one must free their mind by realizing that religious ideas like good and evil, male and female, can be broken. 4. The writers challenge these binary ideas by questioning what is real, using a story about a cold-hearted God that doesn't believe in choice and a savior that doesn't believe in rules. Since it is now quite obvious that through the Wachowski brothers' words, we can see that they want to promote a world of relativism. It makes perfect sense that they would also want to kick against the idea of hope with the skewed perception of a savior that believes in a world free of laws. At the end of the first movie, Neo speaks to the machine world, and while admitting he doesn't know the future, Neo announces his desire to free humanity from rules and laws. Neo admits a desire to be in a world without this machine god, and voices a desire to bring humanity into a world where anything is possible. The Bible has a very different understanding of rules and laws, and speaks against following anyone that tells you that you can decide your own morals. Romans 13:8 says, "Owe no man anything but to love one another, for he that loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and whatever other command there may be, are summed up in this one command. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no harm to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law." And Ecclesiastes 12:13 says, "Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep His commandments, for this is the whole duty of man." The very foundation of God's government is built on rules and laws to prevent us from ever having to deal with this mess that we live in today. The Bible never tells us that we should follow our own heart's desires, to leave the rules aside. It tells us to follow what God has commanded us. The idea that we can be our own moral authority echoes the serpent's whispers in the tree of knowledge of good and evil, when the serpent said, "You can be your own God." So it should come as no surprise that this is exactly where the movie is going next. The idea that the Savior is in all of us. The movie's own script tells us that people in the movie begin to realize that they too can be their own Savior, or God, in future installments of The Matrix.
The path of the one is made by the many.
On top of that, anyone could have been the one that guided everyone to this understanding.
You know the difference between us, Tom? Anyone could have been you. Or as I've always been anyone.
The idea that you can be your own God. The first lie to humanity from the serpent.
We were on our way to remake your world.
Change a few things.
Here, we can finally see that the same Hollywood story repeats itself with its subtle doctrine of, you can be your own God. There is no truth.
and destroy the machine like lawkeepers.
I don't know the future. I didn't come here to tell you how this is going to end. I came here to tell you how it's going to begin. I'm going to hang up this phone, and then I'm going to show these people what you don't want them to see. I'm going to show them a world without you. A world without rules and controls, without borders or boundaries. A world where anything is possible.
Come with me, and you'll be in a world of pure imagination.
No right, no wrong, no rules for me.
Although the final script isn't written yet, Neo has demonstrated that his superhuman powers can be transferred to the real world. And the character called Trinity has demonstrated that these prophesied powers are not confined to Neo. So the stage is set for the conclusion of this movie to involve every character in the human cities achieving this godlike superhuman power to defeat the god machine and take back their planet. It's the same message that Hollywood has driven forward from the very beginning, and Satan has belted from that tree of knowledge of good and evil in the Garden of Eden, provoking all to desire to be like God and engage in the final battle with a God that bases his government on rules like a machine to save the world. Almost exactly what happened in DC Comics.
The big climax to Grant's run near the end of the 90s was World War III, which climaxed with every man, woman, and child on Earth temporarily inheriting superpowers so that they could team up with the Justice League to fight off Armageddon from above. It was the most amazing sight. 6 billion people all rising from the Earth, all flying. Look up in the sky. It's 6 billion people.
Strangely similar to another story we know so well.
We're still telling the same stories we've always told, just with different names, different faces.
Ergo, one has to wonder, is there a reason for this? Is there any new story? Or are we being mesmerized by the same story told with different faces?
Oh, déjà vu.
Perhaps it truly is just déjà vu. For this is the exact same story we have been told over and over again. Or perhaps it's just a glitch in the Matrix. But do you agree that these stories are often told and seen over and over again? Is it simply just to make money? Or is there something more nefarious behind it? Let us know in the comments below.